So thank you very much, Pace, for this introduction. And I'm really happy that I can be here. I was traveling around Halkidiki and the Mount Athos the last days, and it was really impressive. And so finally, I'm really honored to be here, to be part of your great meeting. I loved the discussions before, because that is exactly what we need, these controversy discussions and not this mainstream. So actually, to be honest, this title, Basic Microsurgical Principles and Their Role in Resident Surgical Training, was not so easy to transfer to a presentation, and it finally got a little bit theoretical, but nevertheless, I'll try my best. So what is, how do we advance, So. What is relevant? What are relevant aspects? And I think the aim we have in residence training for...
I think probably you can use the... Is there a laptop there?
Oh.
Yeah,
probably. Oh, okay. Yeah, it's even better when I know what I want to say. Okay, thanks. Is that the residents and fellows achieve skills and as much experience from their teachers in a short period of time. So finally, they can use this basis for further development of ophthalmic surgery and even get better over time as their teachers. But there's one principle that is extremely important: do not harm the patient. So everything is for the benefit of the patient's eye. So in conclusion, this means we need a concept that as many skills and as much experience as possible is transferred to the resident and to the fellow before they start doing surgery in a real patient eye. And I think this is a responsibility of the teaching faculty. So we need concepts that has to be integrated in this resident training. And I don't know exactly how this works in Greece, but at least in Basel University, these concepts are not really established very much. So it's still the opinion, at least of the residents and the fellows, I can only learn by doing. And I think this is a wrong concept. So what are the steps and the options in training of ophthalmic surgery? So first of all, I think there's a real relevant position for theory, because you need theoretical knowledge about tissues and their behavior and the principles of microsurgical techniques. This is very important, because not every surgery works as it was intended to work, and so you have to change your strategy, and to get a new strategy, you have to know how tissues and instruments and everything behave. Then the second step is simulation and dry exercise. So you know what your machines and instruments are doing. You get familiarized with your team and communication during surgery is an extremely important topic. And you do some simulation, because everything you do, if you care for your instruments, if you care for your machine, has to be, you have to do it, to be able to do it in sleep, because when you get in the first time in a patient's eye, this definitely is related to stress. I hope so it's related to stress, because otherwise they will not get a good surgeon. And so you want to reduce all the stress which is related to running the machines and the instrumentation. And so finally, it's real-world surgery. It's training in a patient's eye. And never forget, even in this period, observation, which means assistance to surgery, is extremely important, because if they observe, they can avoid many of the mistakes they see for the future, and they learn a lot of good procedures they may not be used to. And even me, after 40,000 of cataracts and 6,000 of vitrectomies, I still learn, even if I do assist to a resident or a fellow who is learning. Sometimes they have great ideas, and I say, oh, why didn't I have this idea? And sometimes they have complications. I say, okay, maybe this is good to know that it can happen, so I don't need to do it. So let's start with theory. The theoretical knowledge about the tissue and its behavior is extremely important. You have to understand it and you have to remember it once you come into a situation that may change or needs a change of your strategy. And of course, the principal understanding of the microsurgical techniques. And to be honest, I'm a little bit biased. This is a real nice book from Georg Eisner. He was my first teacher. It was not easy to have him as a teacher because he was very strict, but he was extremely consequent. And this book, it's from 1990, but I really believe it's still absolutely actual because he describes the principal techniques, the principal behavior of the tissue, the principal behavior of the instruments, and this is just three examples from this book. How to handle the forceps, how to use viscoelastic to manage the anterior segment in the middle and right side, how to do a capsular access, not teaching how to do it, but telling exactly all the vectors, all the forces that are with it, and this is what what the surgeon needs if he has to adapt his technique to whatever happens during the surgery. So for me, this is one of the most important books, and I really recommend it everybody to read it before they start doing surgery for our residents and fellows. Second, after you know what you want to do, is simulation and dry exercise. You have to know, which is a little bit of theory, your machines and instruments, and you have to be used to handle them so you don't have to think about, oh, which step do I have to do now? Where do I have to step on my pedal or so when you start surgery in a live patient? For example, what I always experience in our fellows, they come up and they got a phaco machine, and sometimes they even don't know exactly what settings they would like, but you have to remember these phaco machines, or even vitrectomy machines, have different pump systems. There can be a peristalting pump or a venturi pump, and they do behave totally different. So if you step on a pedal in a peristalting pump, the effect is totally different to a venturi pump, and you have to know that, even if you have the same settings with vacuum and flow finally. So a peristalting pump is just guaranteeing the flow, which is given by the foot pedal, and the venturi pump is just guaranteeing the vacuum, which means the holding tissue is totally different because the peristalting pump will increase the vacuum and by this increase the force to hold the tissue, whereas the venturi pump is exactly keeping the force to hold the tissue, but will alter the flow secondary to that. So this has, you have to know that, and you have to exactly to know how to run these machines to be safe. Okay, yes. And so finally, we get to simulation and dry exercise. And I think the team and communication is extremely important. You have to speak the same language, and the same understanding is important. I always remember I was at the university eye clinic for 16 years, and at that time I made my own chopper, and they called it Printe chopper finally. And then I was in another position for a couple of years. I came back, and so I had a different name for it, because for me it's a golf club, because it really looks like a golf club. But this was lost, so I came back and was sitting in surgery and said, okay, I need my golf club, and nobody knew what it is. So make sure everybody is speaking the same language and is understanding the same when you speak. And furthermore, you want to have an agreement with your teacher and with your scrub nurse. And I think everybody of us would is loving a situation like this, calm teaching, very nice, but if you're not used to do it, can also be different, and this may be not really what you want. And so do it in advance, get a consensus on how it works. So finally, dry exercise in model eyes, We got very nice tools with model eyes, and of course the wet labs with pig eyes, so which is a little more realistic. And you can really do a lot of training to get used to use your sutures and suture, for example, like this case, cornea correctly. And if you feel safe and if you're really used to do it, then you can transfer the same skill to a patient eye finally. And I'm very happy to say that Paris and his team in Thessaloniki at the Ophthalmica Clinic and Cesis and myself at the University Eye Clinic in Basel, we are trying to set up a very comprehensive course with simulation and with a wet lab to be run in Greek, and I hope we'll get it done in the next year, maybe the year after that. But I think this is a very nice project, and I'm really happy that I'm involved in this. So finally, the last step is real-world surgery, and it's training in patient's eye. And what I usually suggest to my residents and fellows, to do the procedure from the last steps in surgery and then advance going forward. And this is, in my view, it's much easier because if you do something not perfect in the beginning, for example, you have a problem with your axis, you even can have a small axis. Many of the residents in the beginning tend to do small axis, but this increases the risk for further complications because the aspiration of the cortex is more difficult, the management of the nucleus is more difficult, and so finally, you can be very comfortable if you start from the end by aspiration and implantation, then the next step could be phacoemulsification, and finally you start with the whole procedure from the beginning. And all over your life, as I said before, I think observation and assistance is extremely important, and it's particularly important when you already got skills and experience, because then you see it from a totally different perspective, and you start to see things you never saw before, before you had your own experience. So I love to assist, actually, because I learn so much, and of course I can teach so much, and so this is a very nice experience. So, as you see here, once you get into a situation, assisting of course, where small pupil, for example, and you find out and all the mistakes you shouldn't do, but also the procedures that that work in these cases, for example, how do you do a capsular axis? You really find out nicely if you see a capsular axis done in a situation where the pupil is smaller than the capsular axis that should be done. And finally, you find out that the orientation is not only exactly the rupture where the capsular axis runs, but the more important thing to me is the part of the capsular axis, the flap that you move, and by identifying the flap and seeing the form of the flap, you can exactly say what your capsular axis is doing. So I think this is a great experience, and nicely you see the flap, I hope so. And so the axis itself is one under the iris, actually, because the iris is smaller than 5.5 millimeters. But you can do this safely once you understand how the principle works. And also, as my last fellow did, he made videos from everything, even from handling the instruments. And this is, it's really extremely helpful if you try to check all the different aspects of doing surgery, not only what is in the microscope. So, in summary, there are many important aspects in residents' ophthalmosurgical training. It's first of all theory, to understand and to remember what exactly the tissue does, the instruments do, and it's a lot of theoretical knowledge about tissue and their behavior. The principal understanding of the microsurgical technique, I think this is the basis for everything that's coming after this. then simulation and dry exercise until the residents really feel safe in running everything. And this is mainly to avoid unnecessary stress during clinical cases. You have to know exactly the machines, the instruments, the microscope. Team and communication is important, and of course, simulation. And finally, it's a step in the real-world surgery, and even then, observation and assistance to avoid falls and find out helpful maneuvers. And this is the reason this is really a plaidoyer for a very tight, comprehensive course or program, internal program for teaching surgery. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.